Welcome to River Basin What Advances. My name is Andreas de Jong. In today's video, I want to talk about evapotranspiration and how we can download free evapotranspiration data from the MODIS dataset. I hope you enjoy it. A catchment is the total area contributing to stream flow at a downstream location such as a dam. Precipitation is the main input to the water balance of a catchment. In a previous video, we looked at how to download the CHIRPS dataset for the Salma Dam catchment in Afghanistan. Please look at the video if you've not already done so. Evapotranspiration is an important output to the water balance of a catchment. In today's video, I will show you how to download free evapotranspiration data over a catchment. We will use the MODIS dataset and do the processing in the cloud using Appears. I'm assuming that you've already watched my previous video on MODIS evapotranspiration. If not, please have a look at it. We're going to work on the Salma Dam catchment in western Afghanistan. The Salma Dam was completed in 2016 and it is located on the Harirut River in the west of the country. What we will do is to calculate the total evapotranspiration over the Salma Dam catchment and produce a daily time series over the past 20 years. Then we will use an Excel template to calculate the average monthly evapotranspiration and potential evapotranspiration rates. We will also look at how evapotranspiration has changed over the past 20 years. We'll use the catchment shapefile which we made in the previous video using QGIS. This should be zipped for easier uploading. Then we'll go to the Appears website via the internet to access, process and download the MODIS evapotranspiration data. Finally, we'll process the data in Excel. Okay, let's get started. The first step is to prepare the catchment shapefile and to zip it. So here's our Salma Dam catchment, which we made in a previous video. I'm just going to quickly check the layer series. Yes, it is WGS84. And another thing we need to do is to go to Vector, Geometry Tools, Check Validity, and just press Run, Close. And you'll see that it's all in brown, which means that it is valid output, which is what we need. Now let's get rid of these layers, remove layer, OK. Now what we need to do is to export it as a shapefile, right-click, Export, Save Features As, and under Format you just select Esri Shapefile, and we're going to stick it on our desktop, and I'm going to call it and press save and OK. All right, it has exported successfully, as you can see from the message here. The next thing we need to do is to zip it, so I'm just going to right click, send to compressed zip folder. That's it. We can now go to the next step. The next step is to sign into Appears. So just open your favorite internet browser. I'm using Chrome, but anyone will do. Go to Google and type in Appears. That's APPEARS. And you should find the website here, which is part of the USGS. Appears stands for Application for Extracting and Exploring Analysis-Ready Samples. Quite a mouthful. Anyway, just go into Sign In on the top right, this blue button here. And it's signing me in automatically because I already have an Earth Data account. If you don't have one already, it's a good idea to get yourself an account with Earth Data. The next step is to extract the Mod 16 evapotranspiration data using Appears. Okay, the next thing we need to do is to go to Extract, Area Sample, and on the left here, Start a New Request. The name will be the Salma. The next thing to do is to select our shapefile. So I'm going to select this one at the moment. Just to demonstrate what happens if you use a shapefile which has errors in it. So it's actually plotted in the right place over the Salma Dam catchment. But you'll see later why it doesn't work. Okay, so the product we want is MOD16. There are three choices here. The standard product, the gap-filled one, which is the one we want, and the annual one, which is we don't want. So let's take the gap-filled one. Then we're going to select the evapotranspiration and the potential evapotranspiration. And let's have a look at the bottom. The file format, we'll just say netcdf and geographic. This is going to be the map that comes out at the end, which we actually don't use today. Okay, so we are ready, except for the start and end date. We can see here that it starts 1st January 2000, so let's put that in. You can just type it 01/01/2000. And the end date, we'll just put today, which is not so important. Okay, now we press submit. And this is the message that you're going to see if you have an invalid polygon. Okay, so basically, it will not calculate it because there are some geometric problems with this polygon. If we go to QGIS and we check under vector geometry tools, check validity, run, you'll see that this particular shapefile has invalid output. Okay, so it's in brown. And there are some errors as well, which are located right here. We can quickly have a look at it. So basically, this kind of hole in the polygon will create an error in appears. And you'll have to edit your shapefile so that you don't have these errors in it. Okay, that was just to demonstrate what happens if you have an error. I'm going to load now the correct shapefile, which is this one here. Press open, and yes, it has loaded, and we submit. And you should see a nice green message up here that it has been submitted successfully. And the next thing that will happen is that we're going to get an email telling us that the processing is underway, and also a second email once the processing is finished. Now, if we go to Explore, there is my email, just arrived. We go to Explore, you can see here, this is the job we've just submitted, and the status says pending. It'll take a bit of time, depending on how many people are using the system at the moment. You can just wait for the second email to come, or just hang around and see what happens. Now's the time to get yourself a nice cup of tea, or a cup of coffee, if you like that more. Okay, our request has been completed, and you can see that it has taken about an hour and 20 minutes to do the calculations. So we have some options here. We can have a look at the data or download it directly. Let's have a look first. And from the map, we can see the Salma Dam catchment. We can have a look at the evapotranspiration variations over time. It's in kilograms per square meter per 8 days, which means millimeters over 8 days. And there's also some statistics down here on the quality control. Okay, let's download the data. Just click on the blue button. And here we go. Here's all the different files that are available. So just click on it and download. The final step is to process the data in Excel. I've made a folder called Salma Dam Mod 16. In the first subfolder called Data, I've put all the data from the Appears website. And in the second one called Processed, I've put the Excel template and, of course, a copy of the template because we never work directly in the template. So let's open our copy of the Excel template. And you'll see, if we open it fully, that it's actually quite complicated. There's lots of different sheets here. So start with parameters on the left, and in the green box we're going to put the name of our catchment. And what you see now is that all of these chart titles will change automatically. If you want a different chart title, just go here, and in this concatenate function you can edit it as you like. Okay, I just want to quickly explain to you how this spreadsheet works. So basically we're going to import the statistics CSV file from Appears into a table called Data Original, then we're going to extract the bits that we want, which is the PET and ET data from data original. And finally, there's another table called data export, which is going to suck the data out of here and allocate it to each day of the year. Okay, let's get started. We go to the first sheet here. It says paste the statistics file into this table, which is this one here. Okay, we just select it from the second row, shift control arrow right, shift control arrow down, control C, and paste special 123. It has pasted in all the data, and we can just quickly scroll down to the bottom, and you can see that it ends on the 26th of December 2020. It starts here, 1st January 2000. Okay, so basically we've now done this. Our data has been imported into the data original table. If you go up here on the left, you can see that this is our original data table. Okay, the next thing which we need to do is go to the next sheet. And it says in here, paste the date, 8-day ET and PET data into this table. Okay, so on this column C, if we scroll down, you can see that it goes all the way to the 26th of December 2020. So next year you might want to extend that a bit, but for this year this is still okay. Now what we want to do here is never touch these yellow ones because they're automatic. We want to copy paste the evapotranspiration data into this column and the potential evapotranspiration data into this column. If we go to our statistics file and we click here on dataset, we can actually filter it. So let's remove the PET at the moment, we just get the ET. And the one we want is the mean data in column J. So just go like this, shift control arrow down, control C, and go in here and just paste it. Let's check it has actually filled all the way to the bottom. Yes, it has. And now we want also our potential evapotranspiration data set, so we select that one. Again, go to mean, shift control arrow down, control C, and paste special. Check that it hasn't exceeded the bottom. Yes, everything is okay. And now you can see what's happening here is that this automatic calculation here is for the month. And here it calculates the evapotranspiration per day. Because if you've watched my previous video, you'll know that this is actually evapotranspiration over an 8-day period. Okay, so it calculates what is the ET and PET per day for every one of these 8-day periods. Now it's really important that at the bottom here we also add the end of the year. Yeah, because if there is nothing here, then the formula gets confused and they'll put a zero because it's always looking for the next date. So we're gonna do control Z, and it's okay again. Okay, so we've now completed the second step, which is the table 2 of data processed. And we can already have a look at our data here. So this is now the 8-day composite data, those millimeter of water over 8 days for the entire period of record. And you can see the dark red line is the evapotranspiration, so the actual evapotranspiration, and the thinner one is the potential evapotranspiration. This is our third table, which is the export table. And just to remind you, it's going to suck data out of the process data and it'll make this table which we need for the subsequent calculations. Now you don't have to do anything in here except make sure that the dates cover the entire date range. Okay, so up till the 31st of December 2020. So now these are not every 8 days, they're individual days, so the 1st of January, 2nd of January, 3rd of January, and so on. And what it does is it calculates again what month is it, and it'll use index and match to suck out the evapotranspiration and potential evapotranspiration data from the processed data table. So it basically goes here, here, and if we go to the top here, it's going to look at between the 1st and the 8th of January, we should have 0.4 and 3.3 for our data. So it's 0.4, 0.4, you see, up till the 8th, and 3.3. Now, I haven't checked each of those, but it looks like it's working correctly. If you see any mistakes, please let me know. Okay, so now what we have is the daily actual and potential evapotranspiration over the catchment in millimeters per day. And if you just compare it with this one, see this was at 70, so now it's at about 9, so that's about right. Okay, so now that we have our daily data, what we can do is calculate some monthly averages. What you need to do here is to refresh, okay? Because this data from the previous calculations, you can see in green up here, it's reminding you to refresh. So basically here is a pivot table that sucks out the data and calculates the average evapotranspiration per day for each month of the year over this period of record. And then again here, this table will come and get this data, which is then linked to our graph down here. Okay, sorry, it's actually a chart. Now, it's a bit of an automatic chart. Don't forget that the title can be changed here in the parameters if you don't like it. So what we see here is the average monthly evapotranspiration and potential evapotranspiration rates over the Salma catchment. So you can see that the potential evapotranspiration rates are at their maximum in July, but actually at this time the actual evapotranspiration rates are quite low, probably because there's not much water around. There's also here a pivot table and a pivot chart of the monthly time series. So you can see the millimeters of water that has evaporated per month over our period of record. So you can see in some years where there's been some higher or lower data values. And this one here, it calculates the annual evapotranspiration over the catchment. So you can see that actually it's been going up. It's been going up over the time period. And if you've watched the CHIRPS video, you can see it's actually because the precipitation has increased over our period of record until the year 2000. 2021, of course, is a drought, so I also expect evapotranspiration rates to be lower for this year. Finally, there's a report, which basically is just a copy of these charts, which you've already seen, and a bit of a table here at the bottom. Okay, I think that's all for our little template here. It's actually quite fast. All you need to do is do a bit of copy-pasting, and you can quickly update the data for your catchment or maybe multiple catchments. Thanks so much for your attention. I hope that you found this video interesting and useful, and that you will calculate evapotranspiration rates for a catchment or even a whole river basin in your part of the world. If you have any questions, please leave a comment in the description below. I hope to see you on the next video.